Clock, so we're going to open up our one and only discussion tonight. It's for planning and zoning, but before we jump in, we have one member potentially of the audience who might want to say something in the public speaking portion of the evening. If you do, you can jump on in. If not, we'll jump into our discussion.
Thanks for the opportunity. My name is Greg Lewis. I'm a resident of Northampton. I'm not here to offer any public comment, but I saw the agenda and it fits in nicely with my master's work at UMass. I'm studying for a planning degree, currently in the middle of a thesis. If people would be open to a conversation down the line outside of this meeting, I'd really appreciate that because I have some specific questions about things you've been working on. So if anybody's amenable to conversations, that would really help me out. Thank you.
Okay, super. Thank you. Okie doke, who's, wait, is this your turn?
Yes.
Okay.
So this is very informal, so I have a presentation, but, you know, we can ignore the presentation and go on tangents, so everyone do. But just sort of some background. So Sustainable Northampton, you guys have all lived with and done a lot of implementation of the plan, but the two of you were on the board when we adopted it? Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So everybody else wasn't here when we adopted the plan. What we did in 2008 is we did a big process. We started with a national team coming in from American Institute for Architects to sort of challenge us, get us to think about things. Then we hired a consultant to do the plan. Big community process. Our last plan had been 30 years earlier or something. We had lots of strategic plans, so we were drawing a lot of city documents, but we didn't have a comprehensive plan. Now that we have a plan, we're sort of the plans to do it very differently this time around. So we plan to revise the plan in-house with staff. It also means we're doing this as a 3 or 4 year process because there's no real hurry. You know, the plan is sort of a 20-year planning horizon, and which really means if you're thinking 20 years ahead, you really have to adopt it at least every 10 years from my standpoint. So we need to get this done by 2018. I'm hoping we do it before then. To some extent, I do schedules and then other stuff sneaks in. Actually, we're already about a year behind where I originally hoped to be. But we have, in essence, sort of a five-step process for what we've been thinking about in terms of revising the plan. So let me sort of tell you that as quickly, and then I'll walk you through where we are. So the first is, I think the plan is really good. We hired Cecil Group, who put it together, and obviously working close with the community, but they're the ones who put it all together. I think the plan has two real weaknesses. One is it has a fair amount in it about climate mitigation, you know, reducing energy use, reducing greenhouse gases, but not that much about climate adaptation, that is being ready for climate change that's going to come. And so that's certainly a gap we want to address. The other real weakness in it is we asked them to put metrics in, measurements to let us know how we're doing. And the metrics were sort of random. I don't know if we asked too late in the process or they weren't really good at it. And if you read through the plan, there's some sections where the metrics are really good. And there's some sections where they're sort of worthless. And some of the metrics are about finished things. You know, what do we want the community to look like? And some are about checklists. Do we pass zoning changes? And from my standpoint, the metrics should be about what kind of community we are, not about, you know, do we put a dot and an I. So about a year and a half ago, we decided to enter this program called STAR Communities. And you've heard a little bit about this, I think, but STAR, they clearly aim to be for communities what LEED is for buildings, to be the way you rate how sustainable a community is. And so we were, in the first year of the program, we were a pilot community. We became the first five-star community in the country, and to date, only Seattle has joined us. There have been about 50 communities have gone through the process. And it's actually pretty good because the 50 communities sort of self-select to go through the process, so the lousy communities don't do it. we're not going to be the only five-star. You know, there'll be other five-stars joining over time. And there's some things that are unique about us that, you know, I'd tell you if it wasn't a newspaper reporter, but I guess I'll tell you anyway. But you get STAR credit for doing really good things that only urban areas can do. And you get STAR credit for doing really good things that only suburban areas can do. And really good things that only rural areas could do. So we get STAR credit because we're doing great things, but also because of the nature of our community. Mm-hmm. We go from really rural, you know, we get every single point you can get for open space, we get, and we get really urban. Every single point you can get for homeless shelters, we get. And so, for some, you know, so it's good we pay attention to all those things, but it makes our achievements less in some ways.
Other than bragging rights, does it help you with grants? Does it have any tangible...
It doesn't have any immediate tangible effect. But I mean, I'll tell you a story from today. This has nothing to do with store, but just thinking about these things that are bragging rights. We worked to get our bike paths in Northampton to be national recreation trails. We're the only bike path from here to New Haven and here to Boston that's on that trail. And it was mostly bragging rights. And today I was in Springfield where our transportation projects get scored. Under the new system, you get 1 point, which is 1%, and typically successful projects have about 40 points just for servicing a national recreation trail. So the things we don't really expect, we don't really know what's going to come out of it. You know, I was on a panel about a year ago with a group of bond rating agencies. And part of the discussion is to what extent is being sustainable help you with your bond rating? You know,
that's kind of what I was after. Surely something eventually weighs
right.
in.
What the bond rating agency said is star community score per se will have nothing to do with bond rating. We're not going to look at it. But all those things that you prove that you're sustainable, the fact we built a dossier, will help. I mean, the story one of the bond rating agencies said in this session was we called up communities in southern New Jersey right after the hurricane hit. And the ones who said, how can you be talking to us about bonds when we're underwater, were the ones who didn't get a good bond rating. And the ones who said, yep, we're in our backup office, and we're working on our electronic files, and we're good to go. So I think there's things like that that we just don't really know yet, but they're going to help us. It certainly helped us already with grants, just discretionary grants where we can say, we get this, and we're taking this stuff seriously. But so that's part of STAR. The more, and it's interesting, you know, in Northampton, we get some accolades for being STAR. But not a lot of people don't get it. But, you know, the mayor spoke by video conference with National League of Cities and Towns, recent cities. You know, and so all these big city mayors are like, wow, Northampton and Seattle, the two communities that have it. So there's different conversations at different scales going on. The more important part for me about STAR and the reason we did it for our plan is what my goal is to crowd all the metrics that Cecil Group did, because that was, as I said, the weak point in the plan, and in essence replace them with the STAR metrics. They don't, we may want to add our additional metrics of our own, but it gives us a way to compare ourselves to other communities. And so I think that's going to be really useful. So in terms of revising the plan, the things I want to think about are a climate adaptation chapter as part of it. How does STAR serve us in two areas? One is about giving us metrics, and the other is highlighting areas we might be weak. You know, we did great scoring, but the things we didn't get, does it make us think about other things that could be on the plan? So doing that. The other thing, and I don't mean to criticize anybody, but there's a lot of people who talk about the plan and how great it is, and my guess is a lot of them actually haven't read the plan, because the plan is sort of not the sexiest subject. So how do we make it a little more accessible? So there may be places where we can just reduce the number of goals and reduce the number of objectives, you know, sort of merging them together and make it a little more concise. So I want to do that piece. To that end, we've sort of started meeting with committees. So we've been talking to our bike, ped, and transportation committee about that section. Devin's been part of that conversation. We've been meeting with the Energy and Sustainability Commission about their section. We're obviously come to you. So the process we see is we did STAR. We're going to be doing a big climate adaptation process, which I'll talk about later. I want to sort of test formatting over the next year. And then starting in September, October, start doing real community outreach. Plan sort of early 2016 to be the community outreach on the process, and then maybe late 2016, maybe 2017, depending on workload, actually doing the plan with, you know, iterative loops, so we'll come back in between for doing it. So I just want to walk you, I have a few things to talk about. The first thing I want to talk about is STAR and sort of walk you through the process. So this is what Devin was saying in terms of all the bragging rights. But these things, what I want to say about these things is, they add up to a story, all the different stuff that we get. And the story both helps for grants in a lot of ways, but also I think it's important from a cross-cutting standpoint. So, you know, we're talking about climate adaptation, and people think about climate adaptation and making sure that we have emergency shelters that cool people in a big storm, or that we have a microgrid, so if the power goes out, Cooley Dickinson has power. But I also think, you know, there's great streets in America. This is Main Street. I mean, to me, part of climate adaptation is that we have places that you can still walk and, you know, that there's less reliance on transportation systems that may be more at fault.
What's the entity, the STAR community? Who made those decisions? Is there something out there? Who decides? How's that work?
Yeah, so there was a lot of groups that came together. League, I'm probably getting the name wrong, but League of American Cities, again, it may not be the right term, American Planning Association, Green Building Council, who does LEED, Urban Sustainability Directors Network, and a few other groups, I think Smart Growth Network, all sort of came together to create the process. And then it became its own 501c3, but they were part of the process for launching it.
So it's standing out as a independent entity with a board or something that might have many of these people involved in it?
Right, right. So I've actually, we went through the process, I joined their steering committee. So they have a lot of star communities, cities on the steering committee, a lot of national advocacy groups on the steering committee.
And they may change things along the way in terms of whatever those criteria are you're
They will absolutely about. Change things, right. Mm-hmm. But it's a big, the idea is to be a big consensus building process. Mm-hmm. You know, Austin, when they were going through this process, had a citizen petition to STAR saying, we think you should ban any city that burns their trash. Because, you know, you can imagine burning trash is sort of just moving towards zero trash in a landfill, but it also has a risk of reducing mercury. So a lot of those things get debated constantly. And nobody likes everything, but it is sort of a consensus building process. So one of the stories is interesting. I don't know if you could, can you read these things for me?
Yeah.
So the details may not matter as much as they measure you across a lot of criteria. And I'm going to have a slide for each one of these criteria. So if you can't read them, you'll see them later. What's interesting for me is other communities in every single category scored better than we did. You know, Burlington is going through the process right now. Burlington is a municipal utility, and they're already committed to being totally renewable. Zero greenhouse gases for the municipal utility. We can't really do that. We don't own our own utility. So Burlington will beat us. You know, in every category, the communities who are doing more. What made Northampton really stand out, I think, is that we our average score across the board was higher than everybody else. So it's not that, you know, there's any one thing that was amazing in the process, but we're paying attention to every single area, and a lot of communities aren't. A lot of communities, sustainability means energy, which is really important, but isn't all that it's about. And so I think that's sort of partially to our credit. The other thing in terms of the bragging rights piece, one of the things we said is really important is this community conversation. You know, what are the things that really count? So some of you were on the board when Taco Bell came before you and said they're going to be LEED Gold, first LEED Gold Taco Bell in the country. And I think the planning board's reaction was mixed. You know, frankly, it's saying it's a much better energy footprint than McDonald's next door, but most people come by car and they buy food from wherever and they pay minimum wage. You know, and so what does the sustainability really mean? And so that's part of this process of getting this stuff, this, you know, this conversation. I use this picture a lot. You may have seen this in other slideshows because, you know, Taco Bell is good compared to McDonald's, but almost guaranteed that building will be torn down in 30 years. Those buildings just don't have a long lifetime. This building, which isn't nearly as energy efficient, is 100 and some odd years old, 150 years old, and it's probably going to be here another 150 years. And so thinking about that sort of sustainability piece is
important.
What
building is that?
That's the, it's now in Dewey Court. It was on Bridge Street. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the owner of it wanted to build a different house there. They were going to tear it down. Mm-hmm. Somebody bought it and moved it through town, and mm-hmm. it had a new home. And it had its own controversy at the time, but mm-hmm. the building was sort of one of those.
Kind of cute right where it was.
Yeah. We'll move it back there.
Traffic calming.
So these are what you're going to see in the next six or seven slides are the score, you know, how we got the score from STAR communities. What are the things that they looked at and were saying was important? So, you know, they built environments really important. Built environments, everything from making a vibrant downtown to getting suburban housing to be, you know, cluster development, things like the State Hostel being developed, to thinking about bike paths, you know, how we serve all those things. And so they all come together. You know, we just did that project last year, the Small Lots Big Ideas competition, where we really sort of promoted those lots. I'm not sure, Carolyn may know better than I do, I'm not sure the percentage of housing starts we've had that are sort of as a result of the zoning change or lots that sort of fit that piece, but it's substantial. It's,
yeah, it's 50%.
Yeah, we actually have started to see new lots being created. Well, you guys are seeing the A&Rs now. So now that we have to come back to the more for the A&Rs, you guys will see that more. But we've had several. The one, there have been a couple that were just on previously approvable lots. But I think, you know, the new construction is moving forward.
Yeah, I've seen a number of them already.
Mm-hmm. And so these are, you see many of these projects, you don't see all of them. You guys were instrumental in getting rid of parking requirements downtown, which is really important in terms of being a walkable community. You're less involved with, but we're looking at applying for another $1.2 million to $2 million grant for Pleasant Street. That's part of this whole thing of sort of, you know, how we make the urban area more desirable. And so we, you know, this is the, I think we scored better in this category than any other category, the built environment piece. The housing affordability, not surprising, we really do well there. We've sort of retailed our housing program maybe in the last decade. We've always been in, there's sort of two theories about affordable housing, if you want affordable housing. One is you want every neighborhood to have affordable housing, so you don't have exclusive areas where poor people can't live. The other approach, though, is because a lot of people who are in affordable housing don't have a lot of money, may not have a car, is to really focus on transit areas. And we've sort of changed. I think our philosophy, if you asked us 20 years ago, was get housing in every single neighborhood. And I think partially the CPA has sort of been pushing us there in terms of where they've been funding affordable housing and where they haven't. We focused more on these areas that are, you know, on bus lines or walkable distances.
Can you just, affordable housing means is a certain level?
Well, it's a good question. The way the state defines it in this state is we use the federal definition, which is housing affordable to families earning 80% of area median income or below. And the way the state defines it is they're subsidized units, units that are guaranteed to be affordable. The way STAR defines it is a little different. STAR defines it as more or less the same demographic, but whether it's market rent or subsidized rent is the same thing. So in the rezoning change for infill downtown, mm-hmm. if you remember, part of the discussion was how do we encourage affordable housing, and part of it, how do we encourage smaller units that may not be subsidized, there's no money going into them, but if the unit's 1,200 square feet, it's gonna be less expensive than 2,500. So for the purpose of STAR, it's anything that people who are working in the stores can live in. For the purpose of Massachusetts, so this percent that's here is the way Massachusetts defines it. So I'm sort of mixing metaphors, is that the right term? Mm-hmm. You know, mixing definitions that are here. And unfortunately, we've been certainly in my time in Northampton, we've been losing those market rate affordable units. So more and more of the units that are affordable are the units that are deliberately affordable. You know, Danny Acuzzo, when he was alive, used to tell a story that I loved of when he first opened the East Side Grill on a snowy day, he could stay open because people downtown loved shopping there, loved going there. And at a certain point, a bigger percentage of his employees came from outside Northampton because they couldn't afford to rent or buy here. And he could no longer stay open in those difficult days. You know, and so that's because we've been losing the market rate. Portion of the piece.
Restate for me, you said something about the philosophy has changed in the last 20 years. Say that again.
So we've always focused heavily on housing downtown and on the bus routes. So it's not a dramatic change, but we also had a philosophy that we should mix affordable units in every neighborhood in town. So I give you one great example. Off Vernon Street, there was a lot which was donated to the city. And we had an internal debate as a city, did we want it to be affordable? Because that was a neighbor that wasn't particularly affordable. And that was what we ended up doing. We put an affordable duplex on the site. Or did we want to sell that lot and we could have used the proceeds to do three or four affordable units somewhere further out? And we very much said it's really important that every neighborhood have some affordable units. But the problem with that philosophy is at the end of Cherokee Hill Road, for example, there's an affordable lot on the market right now. You need a car to live there. They're not being overwhelmed with people who want to go there because they're automatically eliminating some of the people who might want to go there. And so we've moved away from Turkey Hill Road as the place for affordable units.
Is that aggregating larger density of affordable housing in certain locations? I
mean, no, we really, because the majority of projects are tax credit-driven projects. The biggest source of affordable housing in the United States is tax credits. It's hard to do a tax credit unit project with less than 20 units. So there's always been a push towards bigger projects anyway. This has been on the margins. This has been projects that might only have CPA money or might be a Habitat for Humanity. We're trying to get those spread around the neighborhoods.
You're telling me we'll never do a Savannah again, where you've got all of the low-income mixed in, all at the same housing stock level?
So in terms of percentage of affordable units, I don't know the exact number, but I mean, in terms of percentage of units in the city, but somewhere, and this is really just a guess, so don't quote me on this, about 70% of the city, 70% of the housing units are served by transit. So I'm not talking about any change for that 70%. I'm talking about Ryan Road and Turkey Hill Road and Reservoir Road and the places that aren't served by transit. I think we're downplaying those places. So it's not really going to change Florence, Bay State, Northampton State Hospital. But we do well here. And again, our focus is a little bit different in terms of how we get here. But so then transportation, this has been, I think, one of the city's big success stories. And this is interesting going through the process. About, I forget the exact number, but about 65% of Northampton residents rely on single occupancy vehicles for their journey to work, or how they get from home to work. And it's interesting how you consider that sustainable or not. From a context of any big city in the country, it's horrible. Well, maybe not Los Angeles, where everyone drives, but from the context of, you know, big cities on the East Coast and in Northern California, West Coast, 65% is horrible. From the standpoint of cities that are 30,000 people, it's pretty astonishingly good. I mean, you know, communities like ours don't have that sort of number. So I use the second approach. I think we're doing great. But if you compare us to Seattle, I'm sure Seattle has a much smaller percentage for doing it. Some of these things are in infancy. You know, you see Vision Zero approach. I can't say the city really has this. This is the concept of saying any accident, any crash, you know, auto death, pedestrian death, bicycle death is unacceptable. We need to change our system. You know, we've been focusing on deaths, but not to the extent, we still have debates about how much risk is acceptable or not acceptable. And this is mostly a philosophical approach, but I think we're sort of working towards this in terms of a lot of what we're doing. Multi-use paths, you know about. We have a complete street policy, which are going to come back later. We got this board helped get Zipcar and Smith College campus as part of the permitting for Ford Hall. More recently, we've gotten Zipcar in the parking lot right out here. We do a lot of work for transit. The city pays a little bit extra beyond what we're required to pay to get the express bus to Amherst. We have, you know, it's interesting. I didn't realize this at a recent meeting. I knew we were proud of having two park and ride lots. Until a meeting discovered that in Hampshire and Hamden County, there's only four park and ride lots. So we have two of the four.
Yeah.
And likewise, we have about 10 or I think 11 miles of bike paths, and there's only like 45 miles or 55 miles of bike paths. So we have 23% of the whole region. Now, that's going to change because lots of, you know, Westfield's catching up rapidly, mm-hmm. and other communities are catching up rapidly. But so we're doing a lot of really good things there. You know, we have one roundabout right now, but we have three separate roundabouts that are under design. One of which starts construction next year. One will start probably a couple years later. So, you know, sort of a lot of the metrics that people use for sustainable transportation, we're doing a good job on here.
Which one starts next year?
The Conn Street and Pleasant Street.
Good.
That's mm-hmm. furthest along. Mm-hmm. And then North King and Hatfield's next, although we're only 25% design. Mm-hmm. And then Exit 19, which would be the most dramatic, mm-hmm. doesn't have a year yet, but it's certainly moving forward in that process.
Mm-hmm. We'll never have a year.
It
may never have a year.
It may never have a year, that's possible. So climate energy, you know, sustainability in Northampton sort of spread around. So everything up to here has been my department and you guys as a board. There's a separate department, so Central Services, which is sort of the city's landlord, has an energy officer, and so most of the stuff comes from his office. There's a commission that I serve on that sort of get different departments and different citizens together. So I'm part of this, but this is primarily a different department. The focus there has really been on energy reduction. So this is the climate mitigation piece. How do we reduce our footprint? And also, because, you know, the city invested $6.5 million to reduce our building footprint, and we've reduced our energy use by 21%. So that's gonna pay itself back in a short time period, then it's all profitable after that. We're about to redo all the street lights in Northampton to become LED lights. And that's, again, gonna pay for itself. I've got the payback, but it's like 5 years, 6 years. So a lot of these things really, no matter what you believe about climate change, a lot of these just pencil out and they make a lot of sense from straight economic benefits anyway. But, so we're doing well in those areas. You all have been involved somewhat in the margins. So the increased density close to downtown came with some incentives for low HERS ratings. So this is how much energy does a new building use? And so you guys are involved with some of those things that are out there. Actually, and the, I should go back to the slide. And even this thing about mandated street trees, this is really petty, but I just want you to think about this in the subdivision regs. And soon, hopefully, in the zoning, we're making sure that street trees that get planted are trees that will survive in North Carolina today and would survive here later. So it's that thinking about the different scales that are out there. And so that's part of climate adaptation as opposed to mitigation. Mm-hmm. Economy and jobs, again, the mayor's office takes the lead on this. But they've done a lot from the adult education in James House that's been very successful. The living wage policy, frankly, is mostly symbolic. It's an important statement. I'm not sure it really makes a big difference. To sort of just thinking about what are we going after for economic development. One thing I like about STAR is it thinks about education. You know, in terms of you think about cities where people flood the city just because they don't like the public schools, arts and community. How do all those things come together? We do well in that. I should stress, incidentally, throughout STAR, there's an awful lot of things which we claim credit for, rightly, because STAR just talks about what does your community do, that are totally what our community partners do. So a lot of things, I'm not trying to make it sound like the city's doing all those things. The arts effort, we do have an arts department, which cities our size don't usually do, but most of what we're talking about for arts is in the community. Certainly all the agriculture education is Grow Food Northampton. You know, there's a lot of different players in this part, and what was fun about STAR is sort of seeing how all those things come together for it. But we're playing with different things. You know, this picture on the upper right is one of my goals. We don't have this as a formal policy, but one of my goals is that, at least for projects my office is involved with, that we put 0.4% of capital improvements towards the arts. And so we've been doing that in the bike path. Some of it's been very applied. It's artistic kiosks. We're about to do a design competition in Leeds, an artistic design competition for a kiosk up there that'll be, you know, much more artistic. But just sort of thinking about how do we connect those together. And so I think all these things sort of help create that sense of community. And this category is everything from historic districts to arts and education and everything in between.
It has nothing to do with colleges and things like that, though.
It has to do with things where college contributes to the community. So Smith College Art Museum, for example, is very important. You know, one of the questions they asked us, which we couldn't really answer, but they accept our guesstimate, is what percentage of the county goes to a museum every year? And we didn't really know the answer. We knew how many people went to Smith Art Museum, but we don't know, is that one person who goes 50,000 times or 50,000 people go once? Mm-hmm. So there's things that are Smith that absolutely help us in terms of, you know, John M. Green Hall being open to the public events, but not the routine stuff that Smith does.
There were some other funny things on that that we didn't quite qualify for because we're not as urban. So, you know, about the cultural events or something like that, the ethnic festivals, you know, how many do we have? And like, well, we're not Boston, you know, right. we don't have one for each group that lives here. So there were some interesting pieces along the way. I mean, in each category, but that one in particular.
Right. Sure.
And is this self-audited or does someone from STAR come out and...
So it's a good question. We give them the data we have. Much of the data is, you know, we try to not have to do any statistical collection. We're trying to use publicly available data sources when possible. This time, I think 160 data points we had to give them. Many of them were for public records, and so they audit, I think it's about 20% of what we do, they audit. And then other things which we had, they still audit, but they sort of check to make sure, you know, the museum admission is a good example. They could have kicked that out because I said, we just don't know. Here's the number of people who go to Historic Northampton. Here's the number of people who go to Smith College Art Museum. And we believe it's fairly, you know, it's spread across the board. We don't know. So they order those things. And they look at everything, and then 20% they do some sort of more, I think I may have the wrong number, but some percentage they do a more detailed audit. But certainly we're collecting all the data and reporting it to them. And they ask for documentation for a lot of things. So what Carolyn was talking about in terms of cultural activities, we sent them a lot of brochures. You know, the picture here is the first, when gay marriage became legal in Massachusetts, so the first weddings here. And so you can guess in Northampton, a lot of things we talked about in terms of cultural diversity, gay and lesbian activities, which was eligible, and we would send them brochures for those things. Mm-hmm. So different audit levels for different levels of data that's out there. Equity empowerment is interesting. I would have thought that was one of the areas that we would do more poorly. And in terms of raw score, we did worse than other areas. except that it turns out that everybody does really horribly here. So our lower score actually put us as one of the top leaders in the country in this area. You know, so we do things like we're working on putting a community gardens in at River Run, because River Run is the densest housing complex that has no sidewalks and you can't get anywhere. So because we think we have enough community gardens right now, frankly, for serving all the middle class in Northampton. But that's different from people who aren't going to drive somewhere. And so those kinds of efforts are there. When we sold that lot on Garfield Avenue, this is the small lots lot, we had six lots. We were getting rid of five we gave to Habitat, one we sold for a market rate. And we very deliberately had the market rate house be the one that's closest to the former landfill, because we wanted to send a message that, yes, we think the landfill is clean, and we think that rich people can live closer to the landfill than poor people. And so we at least pay attention to all these kinds of things. Mm-hmm. We're also lucky. We're one of the smallest, if actually, we actually be the absolute smallest block grant entitlement community in the country. And so we get control of our block grant money that cities our size generally don't have. And so we get to do that. So we do a lot of things there in terms of affordable housing and public space. And obviously CPA has now helped us in terms of some of these things.
Right.
That's on the left side of the picture.
So that is the Roundhouse parking lot, the coal gasification plant. That tank was full of horrible carcinogenic forming coal tar, right next to an affordable housing tax credit project. And so one of the things the city did at some risk to ourselves is we dug in the ground and found out the site was contaminated, and we reported to DEP. And then fortunately, we were able to get the Bay State Gas on the hook, and Bay State spent something like $7 million cleaning it up. But I think it was credit to the city that, you know, I was the one who took the lead on that part. Nobody ever suggested we don't do our due diligence. And in the beginning of due diligence, we knew we were taking a risk for doing it. But, you know, the one on the right is, this is now a dated piece, but when this project was done, it had the cot shelter, still is the cot shelter, and at the time, it had the most expensive condos on a per square price of any project in town. That's no longer true, but, you know, so again, and that project happened in part because we put block grant money in for the homeless shelter. And even though it was a tiny percentage of the project, we were the first dollar in. And in return, we knew we were putting the block grant money in. We wouldn't get it. It wouldn't open for 2 years. But that was, at the time, the mayor's commitment to create affordable housing in this mixed-use building. So it's those kind of projects that help us. So health and safety, this has been fun. This is, if you talk to planners, you know, 30 years ago and today, this is certainly one of the areas where health and planning were sort of much more separate fields, and, you know, health people looked at restaurant range hoods and insects, and planners looked at bike paths, and there's now been much more crossover. We're the lead community for a four-town effort, Belchertown, Amherst, Northampton, Williamsburg, to bring in state money, and we're applying for some federal money to sort of look at these things together. You know, this is fun actually dealing with this category, dealing with police and fire, who didn't really think of themselves as being sustainability pieces, but we asked them for the data and they did a great job. I mean, we got a lot of points from work that police and fire are doing in terms of community outreach and how well we're scoring in these things. You guys were involved in this piece about no build in the 500-year floodplain, sort of as a surrogate for climate change. Mm-hmm. So all those things, you know, come together in this area. Natural systems, not surprisingly, is one we've done well. You know, we've been aggressive at buying open space, both for sort of natural areas and also to serve all the neighborhoods in town. And so I think we got, in this part of it, we did incredibly well in terms of scoring pieces. And we did some unique things. So when we've been buying land, this has only been true for about 6 years, but we've been endowing the land. So when we say we're buying land, you know, getting contributions and grants for buying land is sort of sexy. Getting contributions for maintenance isn't so sexy. Mm-hmm. And we said, it's part of the package deal. We buy an acre of land, we're gonna put $200 at Community Foundation of Western Mass. We have no legal right to ever touch that principal, but the interest comes to the city every year for maintenance, for capital improvements. And so, you know, we've only been endowing it for 6 years, so we don't have all our land endowed, but it's sort of a step forward. We've been doing the same thing for bike paths, that's actually more recently, but each time we add a new foot of bike path, we put $200 an endowment fund, a community foundation of Western Mass, again, trying to think about, you know, sustainability has to be not just the bricks and mortar stuff, but the systems and right. How does it all work for doing it. All right, so next steps. I went over a little bit of this in the beginning, but I want to talk about the very first step I'm hoping you're all involved with. So when legally in Massachusetts, a comprehensive plan only has to be adopted by the planning board. We've always had a matter of policy to go to city council as well, because frankly, nothing against you guys, but it means a lot more if city council adopts it in addition to you guys. And because they've adopted it, we've sort of considered Sustainable Northampton to be our policy. But plans are traditionally considered to be aspirational as opposed to policy-based. Plans are where you want to go. They're not necessarily where you are. And so we've run into a couple things of question of, do we actually have some policies on the books? So for example, again, this scoring about our transportation projects, Pioneer Valley Planning Commission asked us, do we have a complete streets policy? We said yes, because it's in the plan. The question, of course, is it truly a complete streets policy? Because it's not a policy. Likewise, the state's about to have a very small grant program, $5 million statewide, that communities are only eligible if they have a complete streets policy. And so we want to start, what we want to do is basically go to Sustainable Northampton and mine it for all the policies that are in there and go to city council and have them adopt those policies. So that's sort of one set. The other thing is that a bunch of policies city council has already adopted about green communities and other things, which they have. But if you went down to the city clerk to say, can I have the policy, she'd have a hard time finding it, because on July 1st they passed something, and some other date they passed something different. It's not like our regulations are all in one place. So we want to take new policies from the plan, existing policies, and sort of put them all together in one package as a set codification document. We want to think about other policies that fit, and we want to think about star communities and where does it go. So I'm going to get more detail on these in a second.
Yeah.
So to distinguish for me, I understand what a policy is, but for a policy to be firm and enacted by the community and the committees and all the players, it seems like to me it does have to get into the statutes or into the regulations. So, I mean, you distinguish those two as they were different things, but to me, one is leading to the other eventually.
See, I think cultures are incredibly important, and cultures affect a lot of things. So, I mean, I use you guys as a board. It used to be there was a culture that planning alternates didn't come unless somebody was absent. And you've really developed, and it was really hard to change that. Actually, the zoning board, but you then developed a culture. We expect all plan board members to come to everything. A lot of our policies are sort of in that category. So let's use roundabouts from a transportation standpoint. We have a policy in Sustainable Northampton, which says our default position is when we have an intersection that needs big treatment, we assume it should be a roundabout, and if the roundabout doesn't work, we go to a signal. But we start with that. That's not an ordinance from council, but since we've had that in 2008, we've always followed that. So I think these things are as much about how strong is the spotlight that you shine on them. Mm-hmm.
I mean, my experience comes from safety culture, you know, corporate safety culture. And until you get it written down and measured, I mean, that's what you're trying to do. Because as soon as there's not a Wayne and a Carolyn, nobody's going to
know. Yeah. Right. Well, I agree. That's only why we wanted this as policy.
Question as well. I mean, there's the legal issue there. I hear you, in the long run, if somebody doesn't like it and goes after it, if it isn't an ordinance, are you suggesting then?
And I don't have a strong opinion on it. I don't want everything to be codified. Yeah. I see those two things as different, and some things will get in the rules, and some things will be driven by the personalities that are the players.
Right. I think it's absolutely true. I mean, certainly you see this a lot in big cities when a mayor changes and the next mayor throws at everything they do. This is a little different what you're talking about, though, because we clearly codify things in regulations that are private sector driven. So we're primarily talking about how we govern ourselves. Mm-hmm. And the reality when we govern ourselves is whatever the policy is, city council can make an exception anyway. Right. So what's important is just that we have a clear seat at the table for what the default is. That we default to saying roundabout comes first. We default to saying we put a sidewalk in every street, that new buildings are LEED certified. And there will always be a way around them. But I don't disagree with what you said. We want to highlight those things. So I'm going to come to these in a second. Again, in terms of next steps, this climate adaptation plan. I'll come back to this later. And then updating the plan. So I'm just going to walk you through things quickly. And this is sort of his introduction. But you could either give more ideas now or do it later. I just wanted to go you through this. So the things that are in Sustainable Northampton, but many of which are much weaker than are here, is we clearly have a complete streets policy in sustainable Northampton. Complete streets being, we expect all modes to be treated differently. Single occupancy vehicles are absolutely fine, we encourage them. Trucks are absolutely fine, but bicycles and pedestrians and transit are also fine, and they should all be comfortable in the street. So we have that. What we don't have is we never actually have the word complete streets. We never really talk about this Vision Zero. We're a little unclear. We know if you're rebuilding a street, you have to add sidewalks and bike lanes. We're not quite as clear if you're just putting a mill and overlay on top of it. That part's not quite as clear. Transit signal priority. This is sort of a minor detail, but it's, again, important for some grant programs. We say we want streets all to be friendly to transit, but we don't actually say we want transit signal priority. So this is something we have on Route 9, where if a PVTA bus is coming up to the light will stay green for a few seconds extra. But we don't have that on Route 10 or Route 5. And so, again, sort of, so those are things we want to expand the complete streets policy and then make it a policy instead of there. The LEED certification, again, is in the plan. Green streets, we have weaker language. We've been playing with, you know, working with PVPC and DPW. We've been playing with a cleaner, you know, standard for that. And then the affordable housing. We sort of have this implied policy and affordable housing plan, but not really spelled out. So then the second one, these are ones that are mostly all been adopted by City Council, but at different times. So green vehicle purchasing, you know, the inspectors downstairs no longer get former police cars. You know, if they're getting a new car, it has to be an energy efficient car. We've already reduced our stationary source power by 21%, but we haven't done it as much for mobile source power. Fossil fuel divestment, I can't even remember if this, I think City Council adopted this, but I'm not even 100% sure about that. This is sort of in pension funds. And then we have these other things that are sort of implied policies, but we have this revolving fund that the city sells SRECs, which are sustainable or solar renewable energy credits, and that money's going to a fund to get reused. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure it's a formal policy. So we do those. And then there's other things, again, that we have at different levels. So City Council every year adopts this living wage policy. Again, it has no teeth whatsoever, but it's a symbolic piece. It's important to say, you know, living wages are important. We have a very, very weak buy local preference. It basically means if I go to bid, and two bidders come in for exactly the same price, the tiebreaker is are they in Northampton? But we can't spend more money, for example. Mm-hmm. Right. We have a guaranteed ride home program. It's actually not a city policy. But if I, you know, walk to work or bicycle to work or take a bus to work, and my daughter's sick, I can take a taxi cab home to get to her quickly. And that encourages people to say, you know, some people say they take the car for these rare emergencies that almost never happen. And this one's, again, a minor thing that just helps us for details. We have a emergency vehicles route, but we've never had City Council formally adopt an evacuation route, and it matters for transportation funding formulas. It's not important for most of what we do. But. And then, you know, ones to think about. None of these things are new or in various stages. So, there's capital projects for art and design elements. As I say, my office has been doing, we haven't automatically done it. We've done some, you know, this depends how you look at it. So police station didn't have any formal money put aside, but they spent more money on sort of that makes it, the building attractive as opposed to not so attractive. Mm-hmm. They spent far more than 0.4% of that. So in some ways we're doing some of these things without a formal policy for doing it. Greenhouse gas, we have some of this as policies done by the Energy and Transportation Commission, but not by City Council. Greenhouse gas analysis and public policy discussions. I think we're doing this, but this is certainly what Devin was saying. This is sort of a matter of policy. We think about this, you guys think about this, but it's not a checklist. You know, we're required, you never see this because it's sort of in the back office, but we're required by law when we pass zoning to assess its impacts on agriculture. And usually that means we're talking about zoning. I said it's not going to impact agriculture. Don't worry about it. But the state law requires us to do it. It's no teeth, but it's in there. Right. You know, it's that, just that sort of checklist to think about these things. Landfill product bans. We got a lot of credit for STAR from landfill product bans, even though the city's done nothing, because the Commonwealth has done a lot. The Commonwealth prohibits all sorts of things. The city's in the process of considering their first ban in terms of plastic bags. But just sort of, you know, codifying those things. And even the ones the Commonwealth has done, we may at least refer to, so it's in one place. water use reduction, I'm not going through all this, but water use reduction, environmental justice, health assessments, agricultural assessments, all various things that we're doing at different levels out there. We're about to do a health impact assessment on Pleasant Street to help us with that process out there. So.
Wayne, on the landfill products, if the city doesn't have policy, does it revert to Commonwealth policy?
Right. So it's illegal to accept electronic waste in the Commonwealth. It's illegal to accept paper. I'm not involved in the field, but there's a lot of things that we just can't legally take. Mm-hmm. And our diversion rate's actually pretty good. When we had the landfill and we're taking more trash, mm-hmm. we could do a better job of tracking it. Mm-hmm. But I think we're about 65%, but I may be wrong. I'm not sure of the number. Mm-hmm. But somewhere in that neighborhood of how much we're diverting from, landfill. Yeah. Questions. All right. And then so this big gap, again, this is my own assessment, I obviously want to hear from you all. I just want to mm-hmm. present first is we haven't, this climate adaptation is this weaker point. So in 2007, we kicked off Sustainable Northampton Plan with this national team coming in, really just to begin this community conversation. American Institute for Architects Sustainable Design Assessment Team came in 2007, began the conversation that continued to Sustainable Northampton. We applied this year using some of that SREC money to get another team this year, and this team will be more narrowly focused. It's going to just be about climate adaptation. So the team leader and staffers are coming on May 3rd or 4th, and I think Deben and you're coming too. So a couple of you are involved with that process. And that's really a scoping session. That's not a public process. So that's really about trying to figure out what sort of team members do we need. You're part of that too, I think. And then in either September or October, this national team will come in of five members and two staffers. And that's the one we want to beat the bushes. We want everybody in Northampton to be part of that conversation. So that's the really broad conversation. And then they're not going to do a climate adaptation plan. It's a bigger deal. But they're going to help us create a framework. Exactly what does a climate adaptation plan mean? I talked to Carl Spector, who's the one who wrote the plan for Boston, the in-house person. And Carl said, even though Boston's done a lot of metrics, he thinks the most important thing Boston began is just the conversation. They'd never done this before. How do you get every department head to think about climate adaptation? So we need to think about those kinds of things. Are we trying to have clear, measurable metrics? Are we trying to just have conversations and processes? I don't know. And that's sort of what we've got in this process. But what we do know is climate adaptation is a lot of the stuff we already do, just in a different way. So natural hazard mitigation. Climate change isn't a new hazard. Climate change means worrying about tick-borne disease, worrying about, big storms, worrying about heat waves is worse than it used to be. But it's not that we suddenly have a new hazard, we just have hazards get worse. So thinking about that, this connection to health I talked about, I think our connection to food and our commitment to food as part of the planning process has certainly grown, really in the last 6 years, that's gone up dramatically. Land use we've always done, the disease stuff is certainly sort of new for us. But we just applied for a grant through our health department, working again with the same communities I talked about in East Hampton, to work with Valley Medical to think about the whole health system is changing. So if we came back to this room in 15 years, you'd expect most doctors aren't going to be paid for the number of days you come in to see you. They're going to be paid a flat rate for you. And so it's in their interest to do preventative things. What are the things we can get them to start thinking about now to lower your chance of heart attacks and diabetes that are, institutionalized to save them money in the long term? So we're applying for funds to start that process. But that's all part of this process, I think, as well. So I talked to this already. Again, these are sort of these forays of planning. That I always sort of think about how these things fit in. But the accessible and making the plan more accessible is just how do we make the plan more readable? Talk about what we've done, talk about it in a way that people actually want to pick up the plan. Accountable, this is the STAR metrics, so that people can see how good a job we're doing and hold us accountable. Put all these things on our website so people can say, yes, you're doing a good job. This goes back in some of Deben's point, is the more accountable we are, the more that when Carol and I leave, or the mayor leaves, or other people who believe in this stuff, that hopefully citizens hold the city accountable for doing it. It's interesting, you can see this in New York City, where Plan NYC, which is the big sustainable plan that the last mayor had, new mayor has a very different perspective on a lot of things, but I think the sustainability metrics haven't been changed. They're still there because they're sort of a public part of the conversation.
Excuse me, so they're still there, but they're not policy, it's just a plan.
It's just a plan, but just it highlights that, so, you know, how many new miles of bike paths are being created? Bike paths are really controversial in New York, the very fact, or bike lanes. Mm-hmm. The very fact it's there and becomes the metric for community conversation, I think, keeps that stuff going forward.
But so is the broad-reaching goal to update the plan, to make the plan more user-friendly and more open, but at the same time, take a lot of the points from the plan and make them policy. But then over time, if 80% of the plan becomes policy, what becomes of the plan? You know,
yeah, I think
the plan keep getting updated. As soon as you take one item out of the plan, you make it policy, do we fill that gap?
Yeah. I think a lot of the policies are things about city operations. So it's probably always going to be a subset of the plan. You know, so a lot of what's the core plan isn't going to translate well to policies.
Okay.
Again, STAR is part of what made me think about this. I was going through and STAR said, what's your policy? What's your regulation? What's your plan call for? And they had these very different definitions for these things, for doing it. And we sort of, you know, jumbled them a little bit. So achievable, this is partially sort of working with you. You know, this is, the less community is done for planning, the easier the process. I was involved with a team in Haiti just for a week. And it was really easy to do a plan because they'd never done a plan before. It's really hard the more you do because we want to get the public really involved, but we don't want to have them spend a lot of energy to say exactly the stuff we've already heard. So we need to get far enough along that we can actually go back to the community and say, give us new ideas, but also give us feedback on how we're doing in these areas that are out there.
So basically, we're doing what we did for zoning, where we took all the charts and the language, we made it user-friendly, condensed it, put it together in a readable format, and then said, here, what do you think of this? So we're doing basically the same thing.
And, but the last line, the aspirational is, I don't want them to just think the decisions are made.
Right.
So we're also open to totally new areas we haven't talked about.
Okay.
You know, if we did it today, food, as I say, is very weak in the plan. So there's no amount of codifying helps. We just want to go out to the community and get people's input about food stuff.
But, okay.
It's both. It's all those things together. All right, so I'm going to get into the next subject, but do you want to brainstorm now, or is this something for the next agenda to think about other policies? And
to think about specifically other policies?
Yeah, I mean,
that aren't...
Right, things that I didn't have on my list. So the things that we should actually do and go to city council with formal policies, because that's the next thing on our list to do, I think. Mm-hmm. And
I think for myself, I think I'm not prepared to say, oh, this is what else we should be thinking about. I think taking this in and then thinking about it, then we might bring it back up in the next.
Yep, makes sense.
And I think if we approach it the same way we did zoning, where you did all that legwork, we had all this broad ranged language, which said the same thing in three different areas, but it got tighter and cleaner, and then we got something that we could manage, and then said, okay, now, is this enough? Do we need more? If we need more, what are you thinking about? And then kind of push that forward.
Okay, that sounds great.
Does that make sense?
So let me go up to the other thing I want to talk about today that's sort of distantly related but not directly. So this is potentially one of the least sexy things you ever do as a board member, but it's really important. So we adopt a hazard mitigation plan every 7 years. And 7 years ago, it was really controversial, and you guys were all very involved because that's what led to a lot of the zoning changes in the Meadows and a lot of the zoning changes around floodplain. Now we've done that, this time around, we have no recommendations for land use changes. So the plan's really not so exciting. But it's very important. The city right now has $2.7 million of grants that we would lose if we don't have a hazard mitigation plan. So it's very important in terms of both getting that money, but also tailoring those sort of projects. So it's fairly technical, and sort of guiding us, just as a sense of how it's not that exciting. We had lots of good press coverage in the process. The Gazette wrote two articles. The Republican wrote one article. We had Channel 22 covered it. Cable TV covered it. And yet, of the two public hearings we had, I think that the hearing that had, well, Greg was at one by yourself. And I think the other public hearing might have had two people, maybe we had three people. So it's not that exciting a subject when nothing's controversial. You know, had we talked about big zoning changes, that would have been these. Mm-hmm. But again, still important. So I'm just going to walk you through this process. You can guess. We think about all sorts of hazards. Again, climate change is not its own category, but it makes all these things worse. And just gets to think about things differently. You know, the picture in the upper left-hand corner, This is Mansfield before, I think it was Tropical Storm Hugo. I may have the storm wrong. And you see a lot of field, there's no erosion whatsoever. But wherever there was a fence, there was erosion, because you think of an anchor fence as being permeable, but when the water's rushing through, it's the same thing as a wall. It stops the water, and so the water gets channelized. And so I just use that symbolically to think about, you know, those things that don't seem obvious when the storm's not here. How do we address those things? We've changed this. We now have breakaway fences at Mansfield.
I was going to ask. It's 7 years. So in that 7 years, are there specific things, that was my question, that have occurred so that if this comes up again, one can say, this, see how important this is, this,
absolutely.
And this.
Yeah. So we've, at the small level, we raised a house on Island Road to be above the floodplain. We've changed the fields here. We've changed the zoning of the meadows. It basically says no new buildings. We've now dramatically expanded the floodplain to cover places that flood less frequently. We've invested in emergency shelters. So we've done a lot of things. Mm-hmm. But, you know, most of downtown, not where we are, but most of downtown would be underwater if our dikes ever failed. Mm-hmm. And they're still being driven by 1949 pumps. Mm-hmm. That are, you know, so we still have a lot of vulnerability. The new senior center is one of our emergency shelters, but if the dikes broke, it's not a good place to be. So we have, you know, we've done a lot of steps, but we certainly have more steps to go in the process. That evacuation plan that I talked about earlier, totally unsexy, but it's really nice to know in an emergency exactly where we're putting, you know, don't drive down Meadow Street in an emergency because it's going to be underwater. There's an emergency response plan that just isn't, and the police and fire do that, and that's actually a great plan that works well. So actually Meadow Street's a bad example because that's in a different plan, but there are a lot of things we've done, but absolutely more we need to do. So this is the context. You know, we have this emergency response plan that police, fire, and DPW do. We have the zoning that you all do. We have these regional plans. There's a lot of, since 9/11, there's a lot of money that flows through PVPC for emergency response. Some has nothing to do with emergency, with hazards, but some has a lot to do with hazards. You know, New York City did a massive planning effort to say, what if a hurricane hit New York, even worse than the last hurricane, and you had a million people displaced from the city? They were moving everywhere. So, you know, we do our own stuff, but we're focused on what happens regionally in the entire area. I mentioned this already, 2.5 million, not 2.7 million. But, you know, sort of trying to think about how do we use these monies appropriately going forward on the process. We went through this whole process that I mentioned about in terms of the plan. We've already gone to City Council for the first two votes. Next Thursday, they'll have a second vote on the process. This plan keeps moving on its own.
Yeah,
it's really interesting.
It's...
Wow. It thinks I'm talking too fast or too slow. Mm-hmm. So we went through, you may not have to read this, but we went through sort of all the risks, you know, and how big are those risks out there, you know. Earthquakes, pretty small risk, and we have a very strict state building code. So the building code sort of covers things. I mean, obviously, old masonry buildings would be badly damaged, but the main risk for us, not surprising, is flooding and severe storms.
Who's responsible for the rating? Is that internal, or is the state say we are a
So PVPC did it using FEMA standards.
Okay.
I'm sure there's some gray area in it, but there's a fairly clear.
And so for the mitigation plan, do we plan around a 50-year flood or a 100-year flood? Or a, you know?
Typically a 100-year flood, but we've used our lead of the 500-year storm as a surrogate for climate change. One of the problems is FEMA certainly isn't a climate change denial. They absolutely know it's coming, but they don't have any measurements. They don't have any mapping. Where they've mapped along the coast or National Oceanographic Administration has mapped sea level rise. Mm-hmm. There's been no equivalent inland. So we don't really have a good model for what a storm would be.
So if we don't have a model, then how is the plan as effective? Or maybe it's based on the wrong information. You know, what size flood is the right flood to plan around? What size earthquake, what size hurricane, what size, all that stuff.
So for now, the model that we're using is 500-year flood. That's the surrogate for climate change.
Mm-hmm.
You know, eventually you might get a little more sophisticated that we would expect the Connecticut River flooding not to necessarily be worse because of climate change. Because we expect a little more precipitation, but less snow. So that springtime where all the snow is melting and it rains is less likely to be disastrous in the future. Whereas we'd expect smaller watersheds to be worse you know, if it, there are predictions about a 24-hour storm would be. That would be moving from, I think it's 6.6 to 8.8 inches in 24 hours. I'm not exactly sure the numbers. Mm-hmm. And so we'd expect some of those things. So we may get more sophisticated. About 500 years is our current surrogate for doing it.
Well, excuse me, for instance, getting off, but it was just a couple of years ago where they had to, they exercised, they closed the dikes.
I know, I went to see them.
Yeah, I did too. I took my son down to watch it because it was just, now what size of an event was that? Was that
so the dikes in theory are ready for a 500-year floodplain. The dikes start serving at below 100-year storm, so about a 50-year storm they'd come in. Mm-hmm. So the bottom of the dikes, the storm didn't quite touch them,
right.
But the bottom of the dikes are somewhere around a 50-year storm. Mm-hmm. But the top of the dike, if the dikes were in great condition, if everything's operating well, are in theory a 500-year storm, a storm that has a 0.2% chance of happening in any given year. Okay. And it's still
wasn't a 100-year storm event.
Right. And we're paying attention to that. I mean, those are still wooden stop logs that you guys looked at. There's some other material they use these days we've looked at, you know, and see if we could ever get money through this sort of program for it. As part of the roundabout at Pleasant and Cons, we're going to be extending sidewalks south as far as Dyke Road. But part of what we're looking at is where it goes through the stop logs, making sure it doesn't prevent those from doing it. So it is very much sort of part of the discussion that's out there. Okay. So again, we've looked at these things. This map doesn't include, I think, an area where the city adopted a new stormwater utility last year. One of the areas you spend a lot of attention on is the area of localized flooding the federal government doesn't map. So Church Street flooding doesn't show up in this map. But we all know it can be flooded with 3 feet of water. Mm-hmm. You know, so trying to address some of those things. This was actually from a 1974 plan, but there was a big, this is well before Irene, there was a big hurricane that was coming up the Connecticut River Valley, aiming right for Northampton, and got to Hartford and veered west and went into New York State. But they did this study at the time, FEMA did the study of what would have happened if, I can't remember the name of the storm, if this storm had hit Northampton. So I still like it. It's still relevant today. So a really big storm tops the dikes. And floods basically most of downtown, you know, creates these islands. And so, and we're never going to prevent this kind of storm. You know, at some point this storm will hit us, but we just want to make sure we're ready. We want to make sure that the police department isn't underwater, or at least they have a separate operating piece. So we think about these as sort of the cataclysmic events. This is sort of like an earthquake. Mm-hmm. Most of us will live many lifetimes before it happens, but it will hit somewhere, and you just never know where that somewhere will be. So, so again, this is sort of, you know, addressing climate change. This is what we did talk about in the plan a little bit. We've gone to the 500-year flood. The health department's really stepped up in thinking about emergency cooling. Central Services is focusing on this microgrid for DPW operations, for emergency cooling at Smith Volk and for Cooley Dickinson Hospital. And just sort of thinking about, you know, what that process is. You know, just sort of some numbers. Expect hotter summers for a longer time period. So, and it's probably not that our peak days are any worse than our peak days are now. Mm-hmm. It's just that we have more of those peak days. The precipitation, again, 41 to 47 isn't dramatic, but that 24-hour storm is the stuff that we worry about. And so, we're doing this now for what is the private sector design for culverts crossing projects. Again, I'm not going to go through all this, but sort of we went through and thought about, okay, what are the places that are particularly vulnerable for these really big storms? What does that mean? And how do we address each of those areas that are out there? And so, again, the reason this is not controversial is, for the most part, we're not making big changes. A couple of minor tweaks to, I think it was the cluster section of zoning. Community rating system is something we used to do. We stopped doing it because it's too much work. This is an effort to prove to FEMA we do more than the minimum required, and in return, ratepayers, people who are paying floodplain insurance, got a 10% discount. The building department didn't do a certain part of the paperwork, so we weren't eligible for a while. The current building commissioner is is happy to do the paperwork, so we're eligible. And what's happening is FEMA is under a long-term goal of increasing their rates to be self-supporting, and that means probably doubling, if not tripling, flood insurance rates. So 10% of $1,000 premium wasn't a huge amount, but 10% of whatever premiums are going to be becomes a really big amount. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to get that piece. We have an intern this semester who's working on that. You all know what DPW is doing. I'm not sure we'll ever do the undergrounding, but it's only a good goal, you know, sort of thinking about the places where it floods most often. So that's why I say we're not doing a lot of changes. We're really mostly tweaking our structure.
I noticed that there's a $32,000 contract for someone to come in and look at DPW. Will any of this filter into that story?
So that's about operations and how they're run. So I guess they will, you know, because DPW has these different divisions. So in terms of how they're managed, it's not about capital projects, but it's certainly about how they managed. I've never seen the scope, so I don't exactly know what they're doing. But it's going to be looking at all the operational pieces, and it's certainly going to be the divisions and how it works.
I assume that was an outcome of sort of restructuring the committee work that guided them. Is that true?
Yeah, that I think, right. I mean, not having Public Works Commission, and generally I think the mayor's looking at bigger departments. You know, fire department did this 15 years ago now, and police department's done an accreditation. It's sort of a similar thing. So, you know, long term, every department should do that sort of thing. But so because the critical, you know, our plan actually expired last year. We got a temporary extension from FEMA while we went through this process. So we went to City Council to have them adopt it. I'd still like you all to adopt it at some point because it helps us for some grants. Mm-hmm. There's no particular hurry. So I wanted to go through this as sort of a presentation. We can email you the plan, read it at your leisure. At some point, when you don't have a busy meeting, get feedback, and then at some point, we hope you're willing to adopt it. Again, it's not critical. It's not like comprehensive plan that you have to adopt it. It's really just about strengthening grant applications, frankly, mm-hmm. but also thinking about changes that you might want to do with it. I think that's it. Yeah.
Interesting.
That's all?
So on this, so on that portion of it, we'll come back, we'll read it, make some suggestions, vote to adopt. On the sustainable, where you want us to come up, what's our homework assignment for that?
So think, if you have a sustainable Northampton plan, sort of read it with thinking about policies. What are things that should be a formal policy City Council adopts, as well as things in the back of your mind that have nothing to do with it? I mean, in some ways, what's in the plan, Carolyn and I have gone through and thought about. What we haven't thought about is things that we've never thought about. So are there other things that you see people coming in, you say, oh, I wish we had this as a policy, and I can't give you any guidance, but we're open to anything that makes sense in those areas.
And just as a procedural question, since it's not part of a public hearing, are we allowed to collaborate or communicate outside of this meeting? I mean, you know, like for me, you know, I've already read through Sustainable Northampton, but, you know, hearing this homework, like my instinct is just to create a Google spreadsheet with a matrix where I can sort of track, here's a plan, here's my idea for a policy. I'd be happy to share that with everyone if we're allowed to collaborate on stuff. But
so the rules are you can talk to other members as long as you're not a quorum. You can't even indirectly be a quorum. If two of you talk and then one of you talks to another person, that person talks to someone else, okay. That's not allowed. If you take your document and post it, mm-hmm. so that everybody can see it, mm-hmm. that's totally fine, but it wouldn't be a Google collaboration. If they go back and forth, that's a discussion.
Okay.
If it's your ideas you send to everybody, that's just fine.
Okay.
And then that becomes a public document. The public has to see it and can comment in that way.
One nice thing that might work for that, though, is if you even had Carolyn post it, then mm-hmm. it would give us a structure. We could all add our notes into that structure, and then she would actually have something to merge.
Okay.
In the background, are you already assembling that type of matrix, or?
Well, just everything we have is.
We want to make it a policy. This we want to think about. We don't have a policy. Any suggestions? You know, things like that.
Everything I have, I put in that slideshow.
Okay.
I mean, I have language for it that's not here,
yeah.
But in terms of what they are, they're all here. So we can send this to you as
yeah.
well.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay.
And are there, I've printed out various sections of the plan, like double-sided, two sheets to a page. But are there extra published copies that we can borrow or pick up?
Online.
I know.
Oh, it really is.
We can but we can spring to print new copies, so just let us know.
Don't go to the show. No.
And it's fine.
We
have a color printer, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, or Caparis, but yeah. So just let us know who doesn't have them, and that's fine.
Okay, that'd be great.
And nothing's changed. It's from the 87 or 80, or 2008.
Correct.
87, jeez.
It wasn't that old.
Yeah, I know.
We haven't
okay.
waited that long.
I know.
Okay. Well, I mean, the funny thing is, it's been 6-7 years, and, you know, there were all these implementation suggestions, and we've done a lot of them, but we certainly haven't covered them all. Seems like a long time not to
have potentially done more, but.
What I will send you actually is, because it's discussion with other committees, so we have a draft revised chapter for the energy page and a draft revised chapter for the transportation page. Because we've sort of been staying through it, so we're sending that to you as well. And that may also help in terms of letting you see the sort of the format we're thinking about
yeah.
doing for it.
Okay.
In your meetings with other towns or just in your work, is anybody starting to talk about the sustainability of communication systems? Mm. You know, like hotspots downtown. I mean, just, you know, that whole category is missing. How do you tell somebody to go get, you know, attend to the assisted living place, they need help kind of mm-hmm. thing, you know?
Yeah, no, it's an interesting question. I mean, it certainly came up in Irene, where, you know, the cell towers, you know, the old technology used to have 2 days of gas, and now they have like 6 hours of electricity.
Right.
And so a lot of people lost cellular communication for doing that.
We started this process for what was called, it was before Irene, right? Continuance of governance or something.
Yeah.
Where from a, what would the city do to sort of get the message out to the public about where to go, what to do, that kind of thing. But I'm not sure, we haven't had a concerted effort to do that on a big scale since then. That was back when Claire was still.
Yeah, I mean, I think what we have is, we have a lot of individual things. I mean, since the big blackout, Smith College has this microgrid there itself. So assuming gas isn't interrupted, right? Smith mm-hmm. can stay online with, yeah. so you can go charge your iPhone at Smith.
Thank you, if you can get there.
Yeah,
you can
yeah.
get there.
That's in essence what the city is trying to do for the microgrid up by DPW and Cooley Dickinson Hospital over there. Certainly the city's, more and more of the city's operation is on the cloud. So our website will still be operating when Northampton's underwater, because it's no longer in Northampton, it's being processed elsewhere.
And where does the 911 system go?
It's also in the cloud, so it's not here.
Physically, where do they move to?
You mean like just that, like the equipment?
What's at the fire station right now?
Fire station's supposed to be hard. You know, they're clearly located, they're not in a floodplain. Even if the dikes fail, the fire station is supposed to be secure. All the servers in this building are backed up to the fire station, so we duplicate things.
If there's a fire, there's still got to be some alternative.
Yeah, I don't know the answer. I mean, it's a good point. I don't know the answer. I suspect there is. It used to at least be the state police barracks for emergency communication, that they could roll over 911 automatically to state police.
Okay.
I assume that's still true, but I don't know the answer doing. And obviously, the reverse 911 now has phone number, you know, landlines and cell phones and all those sorts of things. But
I don't want to keep Bill here any longer, if you had Wi-Fi downtown, all over downtown, mm-hmm. is anybody going to give you some credit for that? Because it does keep people from traveling. I mean, there's
yeah.
I haven't seen it on anybody's list.
Well, it wasn't a list. And Danny Cuso really wanted to do it for the bid. Yeah. Unfortunately, the bid doesn't exist anymore. And Vanessa Quadra, our last IT director, was at least doing it for Pulaski Park and for City Hall, but Danny's goal was to bring them all together.
It was underway for bid.
Yeah.
They were looking into it and looking, they did a survey which buildings they should be, the transponders, whatever should be on, and then it just.
But what I'm after is, does something in your plan check the box for that?
No, not right now.
So as a policy.
Yeah. Mm.
Okay, anything else on hazmat or sustainable? No? Next up, form-based code.
So this is sort of in that update category. One of the things that came out of the plan, there was a lot of discussion post-plan adoption about whether as we go through these zoning changes for the different neighborhoods, should we have a form-based code or not? And over time, I think we brought to the planning board some discussion of that, how we, at this point, we sort of have a hybrid in some districts because we do talk a lot about, in terms of setbacks and massing and things like that on the street or how it relates to the neighborhood. But we feel like maybe there's an opportunity, instead of looking at the entire city as doing a form-based code, because I don't know that it necessarily works for the city of Northampton. Some other communities have done sort of hybrids where there's still a bunch of, the other thing about form-based code is that theoretically you allow anything and everything. You don't have any kind of restriction on uses. And we're just not sure that the community is ready for that, or it's in the community's best interest not to have any kind of distinction about where some uses are appropriate. You know, warehousing, is that appropriate in the middle of the neighborhood?
Can you just back up for a minute and explain form-based coding?
Sure. So a lot of, so it's a way of looking at land use regulations that are less based on what uses might be allowed in a certain area and more about how they function on the land and where they're located to create neighborhoods. So you typically talk about having maximum setbacks, and you have building heights or the ratio of buildings at, to the street. So it's not so much whether, you know, retail is allowed or off medical office is allowed. And the typically what's done is the entire city is looked at and is divided into these different sections. And depending on what section that geographic part of the community falls, then there might be a different form that's appropriate. So you might have more of a suburban form, lower density units or something like that. It also talks, it deals with the infrastructure pieces of land use. So what does your infrastructure network look like? How does it relate to the abutting uses? So there's a lot about the interconnectedness of the uses based on streets and sidewalks.
But it's an emphasis issue. I mean, you can take traditional code and really downplay the focus on use, which we do downtown. We have very little restrictions on use. You can take a form-based code and really have an enormous amount of restrictions on use. West Springfield's going through this now, and places hit by the tornado. So it's not so that they're totally different. It's really just the emphasis. You know, traditional code starts focusing on these numbers like setbacks and the uses, and form-based code starts the focus on the form, where buildings are. And then they build, they can get to a very similar place, but it's which comes first in the process.
Didn't the last time we talked about this in earnest, we're talking about Green Street, Route 66 as being a candidate for this, that section of the city to,
we
I forget
did talk
in what context that came up.
Probably when we were doing the plan for, when we did the assessment of bringing Green Street into a design district. So
now we've
wrapped that into something similar to the Central Business Architecture Review sort of area, but instead of having it part of Central Business, we created its own sort of design district.
We did partially just because it was so much easier. I mean, you know, the design district was really fast. We could move it through.
Right.
Don't worry about this, but we worried about what Smith College was going to do in terms of buildings there. So we just wanted to know that there was a fast solution for doing it.
So I think, so the idea is sort of maybe it's another way to tweak and change emphasis, as Wayne was saying, in areas where we already sort of have started down that path, or we have more of what could be considered a, you know, hybrid approach, which is Central Business District, because we don't have a lot of emphasis on use, and form is very important. And we actually, when we were going through this, we found a picture in the design guidelines for Central Business Architecture, or somewhere, where did that come up, where oh, it was Garrett Stover, I guess, there was a picture of, you know, if you just focus on form, what kind of buildings can you get? If you do form and design, where do you come? And so it's not just form alone, because you could have buildings that really create dead spaces in the fabric of your neighborhood if there aren't other things just other than, you know, building massing or height. So one of the things that we're looking at potentially doing is creating a pilot sort of Northampton form-based code for just starting, taking off little bites to see how that might fit, how that might feel, whether there's
it's the 20-year plan, you do one district per year.
What's driving the the need for this conversation?
So I think two things. One is, if we're ever going to start form-based code, downtown's the easiest because we're mostly there from a zoning standpoint. Mm-hmm. But the other thing, we've had some discussions here and in other forums. You all generally focus on the private realm, you know, what happens to the private property. If you remember, in all the rezoning in URB and URC, you know, mostly you're giving carrots, more development. But the one stick, if you will, that you said is, when a project's going forward, we expect them to own and fix to city standards the sidewalks and the tree belt and everything up to the curb. And it's always been sort of a de facto policy, mm-hmm. but we disclose that clearly. It's not case mm-hmm. by case we're doing it. Mm-hmm. So first project comes forward, we don't have a standard for it. So someone says, okay, I'm going to build my sidewalk up to city standard. What is that? We're probably going to say, well, the de facto standard is what it is to the left of your property and the right of the property. But we should be coding those things. And so having that, so I think in some ways, the work we did in the zoning sort of is driving us to decide what we want to do for that standard. Some of this has come up for Pleasant Street, where we're applying for this mm-hmm. MassWorks grant. And we'd like to say, here's the standard for what it should be. Some is coming up, and this has failed so far, and I no longer predict it's ever going to pass. But for about 10 years now, there's been a zoning reform bill pending before the state legislature. It may not go anywhere, but what it says, it says lots of great things. I'm all for it. But one of the things it says is, in essence, the standards that you make the private sector follow should be the same standards your own DPW follows. And we don't really have a standard for what we do for city streets.
So you don't have a standard as far as, say, width, or you don't have a standard for the construction of it?
No, we actually have a standard for both those things. So think about the battle. The biggest one that comes up is the battle for sidewalks. Mm-hmm. DPW will always propose sidewalks. Mm-hmm. My experience, frankly, is neighborhoods will usually oppose them because they don't want to have to clear the right. snow. Mm-hmm. I think DPW would love to have a clear policy that says we're going to have sidewalks, that they don't have to be in the firing line, that city council says. But again, are those concrete? Those come up in every debate. You know, North yeah. Street should be concrete, should there be asphalt, right. curb. So spelling out some of the, it's the details. The bigger street, we sort of know. We're doing 11 foot travel lanes. Mm-hmm. So I think that part we've spelled out. Mm-hmm. So it's really the sidewalks, the tree belts, the drainage and the curbs that I don't think we have mm-hmm. as much.
So is it, if we're gonna take this piece by piece over 20 years, are you gonna look at a chunk of area downtown and say, this is what we have, this is how close it is to form-based code already, this is what we'd suggest to get there 100%, or how?
So I think the zoning is pretty easy. I think the zoning is mostly a graphic exercise, changing how it looks. Mm-hmm. The public realm, we haven't really done before. That's the big exercise. And that's one of the debates. One of the reasons that I mostly like form-based code, but one of the reasons I've been resistant is we have a central business district that covers basically our downtown area. But Pleasant Street's not the same as Main Street.
Right.
Do we really have to create sub-districts? And I don't really want to do that, but we may have to do that if we're doing private roads. So that's part of it. We just, so you know, we've applied for two different grants that could help for this. One is, you know, form-based code often talks about transects. You know, think about rural areas to urban areas in different forms. We're sort of, and there's lots of people who've done transects for road profiles. But we're asking for a grant for these four towns that are working together on health issues, to think about transportation transects that are unique to us. Exactly, you know, where should sidewalks be 10 feet wide? Where should they be yeah. 6 feet wide? Where should they be 4 feet wide? You know, what should those things be? That would help in the process for mm-hmm. doing it. We did go to a firm, Cecil Group, who did this plan, who I have a lot of respect for, to ask what it would cost them to do a form-based code for downtown. And their cost was $30,000, which I didn't think we could really come up with. But what they said is they'd be happy to work with us to think about what are things that my staff can do and we could do in-house versus what are things we can't do. We don't really have graphic skills. And so there may be a way to work with them or somebody else to say, I need someone for $10,000 for graphics, but I can do the substance piece right. in-house.
But you're looking to do a unique hybrid?
Well, I would say it would be a hybrid because it's not going to be a true 100% form-based code, but and I also wouldn't say it's necessarily unique because there are other communities around that have done that as well. They still have a whole list of uses, but they've moved much further in that direction to talk about that public realm and sort of how the relationship between the private and public is and what that form is. But I think more we're going to potentially do this in-house, but for just start with Central Business District.
Right.
And we means Carolyn, so.
So is this, are we fixing a problem that doesn't really exist, or are we, it does exist because, for instance, the public, on the public side, the lack of standard with sidewalks and so forth, that is a real problem. And
thanks, Rob. I think the private realm, where is mostly a cleaning up the zoning, making it easier to read, but I think the public realm is a big challenge.
Well, I think it's going to be a big debate too, because DPW is going to be heavily involved. You know, if their design standards about Main Street,
right,
you know, that's the, that then becomes the code for how you rebuild Main Street. You know, I think we've had some discussions about that, and we've had some, you know, a quick design look on what that would be, but it's not a code. We can say, oh, look, this consulting company did this great design for Main Street. Let's go get some money and do it. But that's not the code. It's the same thing as codifying policies. You know, it's not set in stone. So,
right. The other thing to Mark's point, though, is the other reason to do it, I think, even for the private realm downtown, is I think we actually have a pretty good consensus what people want. We just increased the height limit downtown by 10 feet, and I don't think we had any opposition whatsoever to that. Now, had the Valley CDC project proposed first, maybe we would have had opposition, but we didn't at the time for going through that. So I think part of what we're doing is we're going to take Main Street slow as long as it takes. So that's 2 years, that's fine. But then it may give us templates to use in other places where it may become more important. I think there are other places where there are problems with the private realm rules.
Okay.
So I'm not sure how to phrase the question. I'm not sure what the question is, but how does... What's the relationship with the planning board and the public
realm? So this
realm
is zoning. So, oh, in the public realm.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what the reason Carolyn was saying the conversation with the DPW. You guys basically have to decide, with DPW's approval, but it's never been a problem, what are the standards for the people who are doing work on the private realm? So think about Shaw's Motel. That whole site, an acre, which in downtown is a lot of land, is going to be totally redone, and they're going to fix everything between that and the curb.
Mm-hmm.
That's, in essence, going to be you guys subject to DPW's approval. But, you know, right now I think it's asphalt sidewalk. I could be wrong if it's concrete. If you guys say concrete, they're absolutely not going to complain about that. They're going to love that. So
right. It's
mostly going to be you guys in the lead for that. Mass DOT is going to rebuild parts of Bridge Street. We're usually not even involved with that. We'd like to sort of merge those conversations together.
Well, but it also goes to, you know, let's say something, a private developer has to improve the sidewalk on Bridge Street, and the widths on either side are 4 feet. So if the standard is a 5 foot wide sidewalk, do we make, you know, do we start making that puzzle piece the 5 feet, and then you have these? Or is the default, well, rebuild it and make it concrete, and for Bridge Street, we want 4 foot wide sidewalks or whatever it is, and make that consistent. Because once it's rebuilt, obviously, we're not going to go back and it's not going to get changed again for another however many years, 30 years.
But, I mean, isn't that similar to, we have a lot of sidewalks to nowhere, you know, North King Street or, you know, River Valley and so forth. But it's in an effort that somewhere down the line they're all going to be connected, and when they are, they're going to be connected in a similar manner. Okay. Good with that one. Last up, LED sign lighting, which we've talked a little bit about.
Yeah. Are you guys up for talking more about it? And again, there's no hurry on this, but I know that, you know, when I introduced it, whenever it was, a month ago or something, you guys wanted more time to mull it over and have more discussion about it. So I don't know if it's something that you want to get into, you know, you're ready to get into now, if you've had more thoughts about it. City councilors are definitely fine on waiting, so there's not a real push to that. But, you know, on the other hand, if you guys have a strong interest in crafting it or having that conversation.
How much do we have of this at this point?
How many of these types of lights?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't, they're not a lot. I think the ones that will be moving forward more quickly are all the gas stations. They're changing out their panels pretty regularly. But I could also imagine that over time, there are, I don't know how to quantify them, but it seems like they're probably at least, I can think of at least 10 more signs that are those old box signs that people might be thinking about updating and making them more energy efficient. So the ones that have the manually changeable copy that they
are
might
those
think.
Are those under a size limitation?
Yes, we do have sign size limitations, but the amount of area allocated for the lighted portion or the changeable letter portion is not regulated.
Is there a brightness output that's...
Yes.
So there's not the number of lights, but there's a brightness output that's in those end of sign limitation
right.
that's in those.
Right.
So I guess the issue here is we're concerned with the proliferation of these types of signs and how it will look driving down whatever street with changing images and, you know, fear that it might look like Times Square or something. I mean,
that's well, it's aesthetic, but it's also safety. So yeah. if we didn't have... I mean,
distractions, you mean.
Exactly,
rather, right?
Exactly. But it's also, I think there's a concern about aesthetics. And also, depending on where the district is, that might be a bigger concern than in, you know, a residential district versus a commercial district.
Right.
If we, if those signs can be, are not as, not shielded in the same way because the lighting is are the letters themselves. So there's, so I think there are different impacts depending on where you are. And there's not really a differentiation right now in the sign ordinance about what type of lighting you might have in one district versus another.
Right.
Is there anything in the sign ordinance about mobility in the sign? I mean, obviously
not
with
really.
These writing, there's mobility. There could be mobility by something flapping over and flapping over in our current sign. Do we have anything that speaks to mobility in the sign ordinance?
Well, there's a default that the police chief can make the determination if it's not safe. And basically, we're working on an unwritten policy, and now he's retiring, of, you know, 10-second transition. And then that would be considered safe. So the other piece of it is, should that really be left to the police department to make the determination in all cases, or should we just codify it as part of the zoning? So that everyone knows what that is going into, they can design to that.
Right.
And they don't have to pick up the phone and say, is this going to work?
Right.
Is that going to work?
Are you going to say something?
Well, just, you know, from a planning standpoint, like the discussion about this, it seems like it would be helpful to know both with examples of what sort of falls within acceptable ranges right now within, I mean, I'm assuming either everything does or if it doesn't, why doesn't it? And what are other communities using as sort of the standard and start pulling some of that stuff together in a common place for us to look at so we can actually have some, you know,
some context,
exactly.
Yeah. I don't think we've taken any measurements on some of the sign lights that we probably can do, because I think we have the meter that would do that. The draft language came from bits and pieces from other communities and mocked up a little bit. So there are a lot of communities that I can send you links. I can do a PowerPoint and show you sort of where those came from, if that's makes sense. So there are a lot of communities in around the country that have addressed this already. So it's certainly not something that we're forging ahead and breaking new territory here.
I think that'd be helpful if we had like some context and say this is what other like communities are doing, or these are the, because I can envision, say you're a restaurant and you have your menus posted outside the door, but now instead of a menu, it's an LED display of the menu, and it's animated, and it flips every 5 seconds, or there's video, but the lighting is such that you need to be standing in front of it to read it. If you drive by in your car, you're not going to notice.
Yeah.
Well, is that okay because the lighting is low, or because it's animated and flips every 5 seconds, that's not okay? Or yeah. You know what I mean? Where's the line?
Right.
And I think we need more. I don't know how to answer that without context of.
And are there any studies, you know, from safety boards, transportation, that would say, you know, this is a cutoff that should be considered for that? It would be helpful to see those kind of things.
And because a lot of it is subjective. We've heard a lot of people say the lights at the Academy of Music, you know, that it's too bright and it's, oh, that's awful. And we've heard others on the same.
Just one.
Other say, I like it. Not only do I don't mind it, but I like it.
Alan likes it everywhere.
So.
But the question of where is it? The question of an entertainment district versus a semi-residential district that's abutting something really makes a difference as well.
That makes a difference, but I can see us saying nothing residential, commercial only, but then you get in commercial and then you say what's okay, what's not okay, and then...
What's safe, what isn't safe,
right,
what's visible.
So then in terms of, so that's fine, I can do that look at to see how other communities have dealt with both residential and commercial.
I mean, we don't have a lot of signs in residential areas, but you think of
it's mostly like going to be
Northampton High School or the VA, you know, which we can't do anything about. But there's some signs that just stick out because of where they are.
Right. Yeah. Well, they would be sort of all the places of worship that are in that are allowed to be in residential districts. The other schools that would. Periodically want to upgrade
them. I mean, we have a lot of places where there's a lot of housing, but there's commercial left in it for a variety of reasons from another era. You know, could make a difference.
I have an off-topic question at some point before we move out.
Anything else on LED signage? Now, what do you got?
I'm curious as to how does planning work with multiple projects that might be impacting an area? Because it occurred to me at a Chamber of Commerce meeting about a week ago that Pleasant Street is going to be in a world of hurt for probably a full year. In about the same time frame when the roundabout goes in, HAP goes in, and CDC goes in. And how does that get planned, coordinated, and what sort of mitigation is there for businesses and the residents in that area? Because I think it's going to have a huge impact. I assume that it's being considered in a broader context, but I also know that from my own experience in my own company, sometimes they don't talk. So
I think the short answer is it's sort of planned on the details, but not the big picture. So we don't really make any effort to tell people when they can build and not build. So what Valley does and what HAP does and what MassDOT does, no, we don't coordinate those. What DPW does is they're going to need a lot of permits from DPW in terms of, trench permits to enter the street, permits to close off parking, permits to narrow the road, and an operational standpoint, they're going to sort of coordinate that. So does that help at all?
Sure.
But no, they're not going to do anything about when they can actually be scheduled.
So, but can they indirectly sort of influence all those schedules?
It can, yeah. But it's on the margins. And MassDOT, in a project in a horrible area, they're doing either multiple shifts or night shifts. My guess is that, but that's their decision, not ours. So we have very little influence on them.
Yeah.
So they could do that, but I haven't heard that at all for Pleasant. And that's usually sort of more the interstate or bridges where they're doing that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing is to mention, I hear where you're coming from, but the flip side is that it even though it can be disruptive, it isn't necessarily always a negative impact. So I know, you know, my business on Pleasant Street, I opened 3 weeks later, they tore down the front of the building. It actually was kind of great because we had more visibility. We had scaffolding, we had huge signage, we had, you know, there is a way to kind of make lemonade out of the lemons. And I think some of these Pleasant Street projects, maybe there are some folks who are willing to kind of do that. And, you know, I did kind of daily Instagrams of the construction, and people sitting in traffic on Pleasant Street actually turned and looked and saw my business and they otherwise wouldn't have. And, you know, so I think it is a concern, but I think it's good to kind of see that there's always sort of a way to make the opportunity something a little different.
If you've got the two housing projects across the street from each other, is it better to just have 18 months of hell and just get it out of the way? Or do you finish one and everybody exhales and then the next one comes, so you have 3 years of aggravation?
Sure.
It's a lot of coffee to be sold.
A lot of pants to be had.
That's right.
Well, it's not just, you know, so it's not just timing then, right? It's about coordination.
Yeah.
It's, you know, I'm just raising the question, is it seems somehow to be like on the fringe of a sustainability plan.
It's a good question, and as I say, we don't really affect the timing. We do have a lot of fact in the rest, but it's really DPW and not my department, so I just don't know the answer. I think they're certainly aware of those things and try to coordinate, but exactly how it works, I don't know.
And then parking, when that's going on, is going to absolutely. I mean, right? Park. I don't think I've ever seen parking as bad as it is downtown, as it's been this year. I don't know if it's because of all the snow.
Yeah, makes sense.
But it's definitely in the parking crunch has gotten worse.
And this isn't related to the parking, not the construction.
City's
almost done with we have a parking consultant who's working on making recommendations. So that would be part.
There's a big report coming out for that.
So. Yeah, within about a month, I think.
Great. Will that be, will you do a presentation like?
We certainly can. I think the consultants come up to a presentation herself. Yeah.
Okay.
So I'd say we should do that first. If planning board members can't make it, we're happy to repeat it for you, but she obviously knows more than we do about it.
Probably be on film, too.
That's probably true, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, in terms of the HAP and the Valley project, I guess the good thing is there's not public parking that goes away for those projects.
Right.
Those are private sites, and there's not that much parking anyway on the HAP site.
Right.
But certainly there's no public parking for Valley's project. So.
And just by chance, or lawsuits or other things, they may or may not be happening at the same time. Yeah, we just don't know.
Right.
Or lawsuits.
Right.
Yeah.
Good point.
Wayne, is there any data that parking is scarcer now than it was 5 years ago?
You know, one of the asterisks compare, VHB did a study for us 10 years ago, and then we're doing this current study from Walker. And so we asked them to look. They're looking at slightly different things. VHB only looked at city parking supply. And Walker is now looking at city and private parking. I mean, I think certainly one of the things that's going to come out of the recommendations is thinking about not just what do we control, but what does the private sector control to get that more productively used. But she does have occupancy counts. So at the big picture and what I've heard, I don't really know the answer. But in her tape, we can go through the appendices and the tables. And I think the data is there. To answer it. I mean, our parking system is virtually unchanged from 10 years ago. You know, we built the police station deck, but the second floor is just police station, and the first floor is basically what it was before. And otherwise, I don't think we've had any.
We've been grabbing on-street spaces wherever you can. It's probably just a handful. But.
Yeah.
Well, and the population has not changed markedly over that time.
No, and since the recession, you know, if we were getting about 0.5% increase per year of vehicle trips. I don't exactly know it was for parking, but my guess is the same thing. There's more reliance on cars. The recession has sort of flattened off. So I know more about trips than I do about parking, but I think they're pretty related. So my assumption is that it is tighter than it was 10 years ago, but I don't really know that for sure in terms of the data. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything else? No? All right, I guess that's it. I hear a motion.
Second?
What is so moved? You're moved to say what?
To adjourn.
Second by Ann, all in favor? All right, we're adjourned.